meeting, I stated that citizens and citizens groups already pay a steep price in terms of the time they spend to keep government transparent and honest, and should not be charged for right-to-know requests, with the possible exception of a token fee, certainly not the 50 cents per page that the city charges for printed output. I now believe that there should be no charges at all for citizens and citizens groups making right-to-know requests. I've modified my position since that meeting for the following reasons. Number one, Jane Farini, one of our city attorneys, issued a letter to the state legislature stating that Portsmouth supports HB 646, which would have allowed municipalities to charge for the labor required to respond to right-to-know requests. The letter justified this position by stating that Portsmouth had received requests from companies like Google and companies from California and had incurred large costs. Thanks to a right-to-know request by the Association of Portsmouth Taxpayers, we now know that no such requests were received by Portsmouth. We also know that the council never voted to issue such a letter, that this letter emerged from a meeting with only three city officials plus Ms. Farini. The city council did not vote on this position taken by the city of Portsmouth.
Rick, if I could ask you to sum up, we only have a minute and a half and we're speaking, so.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. Okay, then I go on to mention the statements by Attorney Zellin that were submitted to the City Council showing misconduct by city employees. And I'll get to the end right here. Without transparency, government can quickly become unaccountable to the people. The ready availability of right to know, coupled with an interested and involved citizenry, are key elements to maintain transparency and accountability. Right to know is a valid and important part of government, as valid as police, fire, and schools, and should be treated as such. No citizen or citizens group, or for that matter the press, should have to pay even 1 cent for a right to know request. I urge you to support Councillor Morgan's motion tonight on right to know charging, and go beyond that by eliminating all charges for Portsmouth residents who make right to know requests. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike.
And may I submit this?
Yes, please. We'll give it to the city clerk back here. Next speaker, please, is Tom Carroll.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the City Council. My name is Tom Carroll. My family and I own property at 500 Market Street, directly across from the port on Market Street here in Portsmouth. I recently was reading an article from HuffPost that talked about America's best-ranked cities to stay in 2016, and it did not surprise me to see that Provincetown, Mass. Was ranked number one. We recently had a meeting here in these chambers that was put on by Promote Our Port, a group that has spent several months researching the possibilities of getting a connected ferry between here and Provincetown, Mass. They went so far as to go down and discuss all these possibilities with representatives and brought them up here to have this meeting here in this chamber. Their enthusiasm was spectacular. They truly tried to promote the ability as being one of great finances and great jubilance that we create in this city, a robust atmosphere and finances for this city that you haven't seen before. They were trepidatious at first, but when they first had thought about these ideas, they got involved with it and have now determined that it was one of the best things they had ever done. I would hope that this city will stay actively involved when it comes time for the port to have something new there, and ask our representative who sits on the Pew Development Authority Board to promote the ideas of a ferry service in every possible way that he can. I think that it would be one of the best things that happened to the city in a long time. So please keep active in the possibilities of having a ferry between here and Provincetown, Mass. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Next speaker, please, is John Calabrio. I'm here to talk about the non-enforcement of our city ordinances. On November 25th, Wednesday, Thanksgiving Eve, very busy time of the year for transportation on the street. Numerous complaints to the police dispatch and to officers standing on the street about illegal Uber vehicles picking up and dropping off right in front of them.
made me make a decision, and some other cab companies agreed with me. At 11:30 p.m. that night, we pulled our taxis out of Portsmouth, up to Dover, and left the city to Uber, which brought up an almost 4 times surge pricing for the 45-minute wait. Our residents who live on Cabin Street downtown, it costs almost $20. Beachstone apartments cost them $58. One person got in our taxi on Thursday and said he paid $82.50 to go to Elliott. We charged him $21. We need to enforce our ordinances. They're there. You agreed that they had to have commercial limited liability insurance. You agreed and passed into law that they had to have vetted backgrounds by the local police. Yet they're still operating in our city illegally, laughing at the council, laughing at the police, laughing at the taxi drivers. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Next speaker, please, Mark Brady.
Mark Brady, 285 Union Street. Mr. Horowitz referenced the right to no request, or not the right to no request, but the testimony of the city attorney, or one of the city attorneys, regarding enabling legislation for charging for labor. What he didn't know, or maybe didn't get a chance to say, was that that attorney was speaking for the entire municipal association of the state, not just the city of Portsmouth. I don't know if you folks are aware of that. Portsmouth, it appears, is not so burdened by the right to know. Now, Attorney Zellin did file one recently that resulted in 8,000 email dump. Several thoughts spring to mind. We, the taxpayers, have already paid for that attorney's time. Why do you want to charge us again for it? I mean, there's a sidewalk in front of my house that the city has to mow. Not every house has it. Should I get charged for that? I take a back seat to no one in this community, no council, past, present, or the next, when it comes to watching the city expenditures. Even if it costs a dollar an email to process, in other words, $8,000, I say tough. It's called the cost of freedom. That's what we're talking about, the cost of freedom. You folks shouldn't be charging for that. I say, or we at the APT say, if needs be, hire another attorney. Here's the official APT blessing. If you need to do that, do it. The city should absorb the cost. We, the citizens, should have the right to petition and come before you folks, or come before the city and get information. And it is, a few years ago, I don't hear about costs from city administrators, because it wasn't that long ago when the state street was paved over on Friday, raced on in a bicycle race on Saturday, and then torn up on a Monday for $9,000. $8,000 is cheaper than this. And you want to talk to me about cost? Don't.
Thank you, Mark. Next speaker, please, is Margo Dora.
Good evening. I'm here to support the general guidelines of the Sagamore Creek Committee.
Margo, could you tell us your name and your address, please?
Sorry, thank you. Margo Doring, 300 Jones Avenue.
Thank you.
The guidelines strive to preserve the existing natural habitat, to protect the habitat through modern stewardship practices, and to ensure access to this publicly owned area for all Portsmouth citizens. I hope the master plan process that emerges from this starting point will solicit as much public input as the process has thus far. Regarding concerns about illicit behaviors in the area, I believe that opening the gates of Sagamore Creek land will make clandestine activities harder to occur, not easier. There is one area in small detail in the plan that regards the activities there, access to dogs. The committee went through a lot of discussion about whether to allow dog access on leash or off leash, and at this time it's decided to leave it on leash. I would like to see one area in Portsmouth where the wildlife is free of domestic animals, and I think this would be a good place to choose. Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara. Next speaker, please, Mary Jane Beckwith.
Mary Jane Beckwith, 440 Jones Avenue. For over 20 years, I have abutted the Jones Ave duck land on two boundaries. I, and I'm sure others, have hauled lots of trash out of there over the years before getting disgusted and overwhelmed by the sheer new trash. And then there's the old trash strewn about from when it was an operating dump. For decades now, the city has made no effort to clean that up, not even in a show of good faith in the past year since the Blue Ribbon Committee was appointed. Yet the BRC still refuses to recommend having trash receptacles at the site, citing too much labor needed to manage them, not to mention that by encouraging unlimited nighttime access, people can and will drive right in, have a pile of beers, etc., and not wanting to get caught with a bunch of empties in their car in the parking lot. While you cite that other city parks have night access, I contend that you cannot compare a downtown city park surrounded by city streets and lighting to a secluded 66-acre woodland with one short dead-end access road. The landfill cap fence has been open for some time now. It was installed originally, as I understand it, to protect the cap from compaction, thus compromising the capping system. No sign warns visitors of this, so they and their dogs freely wander its expanse. No pastoral photo of Councillor Spear perched atop it gazing skyward. No renaming of it the meadow. No ever-decreasing mention at all of it being a hazardous cap ash landfill will erase the fact that it is just that.
Mary Jane, excuse me, I'm going to have to ask you to sum up.
This site is 50 plus acres surrounding 10 acres of dump. Stop trying to disguise it under a shiny bow. Be honest about what it is. Clean it up. Keep it that way and leave it alone. That you could be proud of. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Jane. Next speaker, please, is Jane Zill.
Jane Zill, 27 Shaw Road. Thank you for the opportunity to make public comment. I ask that you support the motion of Councilor Morgan regarding the refusal of the Portsmouth City Council to approve amendments to the right to know law that would allow municipalities to charge citizens for the cost of labor and reproduction of public documents. Access to public documents is necessary in order for citizens to participate intelligently and fully in a democratic process. Charging for public documents will only serve to discourage citizen involvement in city government. Additionally, charging for public documents will impact citizens differently depending on their ability to pay. To me, charging for public documents is akin to a regressive tax that impacts the poor but not the wealthy. We need government that works for all, the affluent and the less affluent alike. We don't need government that works best for those with financial means and make citizen participation difficult for those who have less. Thank you.
Okay. Next speaker, please, is Allison Tanner.
Good evening. My name is Allison Tanner. I live at 380 Greenway Avenue in Portsmouth. I am the Conservation Commission representative to the Blue Ribbon Committee. And I just wanted to say that I think the committee did a very good job trying to maintain the property, the integrity of the property, and looking at the conservation issues, the vernal pools, the potential for putting in boardwalks where there are places that people are treading, which are pretty sensitive. The fact that we have wonderful cross-country trails there now. People utilize this park. It is public property and should be open to all the residents of the city. The only recommendations that we've made are just to make it more welcoming to people in the city and to allow them to have easier access. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker is Steve Miller.
Steve Miller, 38 Thornton Street, Chair of the Portsmouth Conservation Commission. I'm going to read fast, forget the grammar. I fully endorse the Sagamore Creek Master Plan produced by the Mayor's Blue Ribbon Committee. Having served on the Mayor's Blue Ribbon Committee for the Pierce Island Master Plan over a decade ago, I understand and appreciate the value of this master plan. The land is a great city resource, and this master plan will allow safer access and allow more citizens of all capabilities to use the resource. The master plan is proposed is consistent with all the uses that currently go on in the property. I do not believe that there are any safety issues with toxins or pollutants as the landfill is capped and will remain so. As the implementation of the Pierce Island Master Plan clearly demonstrates, getting more citizens to use this property will reduce illicit and unwanted activities, and getting more people on the land to benefit from its rich asset access to natural resources and the beauty out there will open up many opportunities for cleanups and stewardship of the land. This is a balanced plan that I fully support, and I know that myself and the Conservation Commission will help implement it. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Next speaker, please, is John Michael Isaac.
My name is John Michael Isaac. I live at 751 South Street, and I was on the Blue Ribbon Committee for the Sagamore Creek property. The only comment I would like to make is that I hope this doesn't become an adversarial situation between the residents of Jones Avenue and the city. I think this property will be used properly. I don't see that there's going to be an influx, a great influx of new people going there. I use Jones Avenue more than anybody else in the room as a manager of Portsmouth Elks for the last 23 years. I know the property very well. I think the new use will be minimal. I think it will be better organized, and I think it's a much better use for the city. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Next speaker, please, is Roger Pitchrock.
My name is Roger Pickroff. I live at 441 Jones Avenue. I'm speaking for most of the Jones Avenue community. That's the five streets. Traffic safety is a big issue with us guys down here. We're talking about child safety. Back some time ago, we had a child who was hit, almost killed on the street, on Broad Street. These issues really impact us. We're talking about also the police department when they come down, and we ask them to come down because we got activities down here. It looks like illegal activities going on with drugs or whatever. They have a hard time getting down there because of other commitments or other something else is more important for them. So I guess the issue there is if you're going to open this park up and leave it open all night, who's going to take care of it? The police department can't do it. They're telling us that right now. As far as what I'm seeing here that's presented on the what's allowed and what isn't allowed to be on that campsite, I sent you people a letter that I sent to the editor. There's some pretty serious issues with that, in that whole site. Polluted water, possibility of leaking underneath the cabin. You had the DES down here this past week. I'd like to know what happened there. So. We're asking instead of building on that site, try to develop another place in the city. We have five other parcels of land that are very, very good that weren't mentioned by Mr. Moore here. Doesn't look like anybody else is looking into it. The cleanup we're talking about here, we have no idea what it's going to cost us. We talked about.
Roger, if you could sum up, please.
All right, sorry. Okay, let's clean the site up. Keep it as the current use as it is, and let nature take over like it intended.
Thank you, Roger. Next speaker, please, is Samantha Applebaum.
Oh, I'm sorry. I got the issues here.
Hi, I'm Samantha Applebaum. I'm 15 years old and I live on 102 Martin Avenue. I'm here to represent the youth that believes that the Jones Avenue area should not be populated and commercialized. Not only is a 66-acre plot used for educational purposes due to the nature classroom that we have located there, we also have the cross-country team, but the growth of people and the more people coming in will make the cross-country trails harder to be accessible. The constant flow of traffic will be unsafe to our neighborhood with the increasing amount of people, and there's a lot of children